Hi, welcome to It's Your Wealth, the podcast edition. I'm certified financial planner David Somerville from Capital Wealth Management. I'm joined today on the show by Jason Pollock, registered retirement consultant. Jason, how are you?
Just doing great.
Things are good.
Great. Happy to be here.
Awesome. Awesome. We have a great show today, and we're going to talk about how to help your child fund their first home. And you've got experience with this. Your son, you know, a few years ago said to dad, "Hey, dad, we should buy some real estate." And
son and daughter. So I've got two out of the three so far have needed some help, which is okay.
Yeah, you know what? It's what we have to do in the 21st century. But there's some challenges right now facing the youth generation right now. And some of the things I've kind of come up with, I've seen in some different articles, is one of the biggest challenges facing the youth is the enormous cost of new homes and condo ownership in Ontario. And it's amazing. You know, I now hear in Toronto, they're selling condos that have 200 or 300 square feet. But, you know, the average cost these days, if you look at it, Jason, you know, the average home cost here, even in Niagara, St. Catharines, is probably $500,000-$700,000, and a condo, you know, $400,000-$500,000 as well.
That's the negative to it. Everybody's so happy that the equity in their house has gone up. But on the other hand, if you're a youth looking for a house today, it's a tough challenge.
Well, it's been crazy. One of the there was a great report actually coming out of RBC and TD, and in 2021. I read a report, it's a few months dated, but RBC said their expectation of 2021 is they were going to see home prices increase by about 16%. TD said they thought that home prices would increase by 19%. So, you know, you think back even a year ago, if you were a parent and you were looking to get your child into home ownership, prices just went up between 16 and 19%.
Yeah, and I think Niagara is one of the top hottest areas in Ontario, and in Canada, I actually think. So it's a challenge here now in Niagara.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not just in Toronto anymore.
Absolutely. We're seeing the Niagara region. We're seeing Fort Erie, Ridgeway, Crystal Beach, Port Colborne. They're all just booming. The second big thing facing this this youth generation with their first home purchase is the lack of inventory. And this is tough, right? Like right now, I've talked to a couple of realtors who said home sales have flattened out. And the question was, why have home sales flattened out? Well, for a couple of reasons. One is COVID is still around and it seems to never want to go away. Two was interest rates going up. But the big thing right now is the lack of inventory. There's just no one building homes these days.
Yeah, it's definitely a challenge to find a good home at a reasonable price now.
Absolutely. Number three here and some of the challenges facing the first-time home buyer is the income thresholds to obtain a mortgage. And again, we've had this conversation before with many clients. It's just difficult when you go into a bank or you go to a lender, you go to a mortgage advisor, a mortgage broker, and your income is $40,000 or $50,000. You just, you don't have the income to qualify for a mortgage when in fact, it will take mom and dad in most cases to step up and help support that.
Yeah, it'll be a few years before they're able to support a mortgage.
Absolutely. Number four here on some of the challenges is the affordability test on properties. And again, we had a client come in, a young client come in about a year and a half ago and wanted to buy a house. We pulled some software up on the computer and I said, you know, based on that, based on your income and your down payment, you can afford a house that's $250,000. And his response was, well, what can I buy for $250,000? And I said, isn't it much there. So it's the affordability is really challenging. Number five here are the down payments. Again, you know, 5% down, you buy a $500,000 house. That's a $20,000 down payment. So it's tough for this generation to find those types of funds.
And where are you going to get it? Where are you going to get that down payment from? And we'll talk about that in a minute.
Exactly. Number six here on some of the challenges facing first-time home buyers is the Canadian Mortgage Housing Corporation and the down payment fee. So again, you buy these houses and you think, okay, I'm great. I've got my $20,000, but you forget the fact that there's going to be a substantial penalty fee because your down payment's so small. So those are some of the challenges. And the final thing here is, this generation of youth is going to have to, at some point, look at settling outside of their city of desire or location. So, again, Nicholas, who was on the show, who's one of the advisors here in the office, he said to me one day, you know, I just want to live in St. Catharines or Niagara. And I said, well, you know, based on what's available, you may have to go to Grimsby or to Beamsville or to Vineland or somewhere else. So finding the right location inside the city is going to be a real tough go for this generation.
Yeah, and we're not used to that in Niagara. We know about it in Toronto. You have to go outside of Toronto to be able to afford a house. But in St. Catharines, it was always affordable. And now it's starting. We're having to look for Thorold or Welland or, like you said, Ridgeway, Fort Erie, if you wanted to work in St. Catharines.
Different locations in Toronto. I mean, there's not a lot there in Toronto, too. But for sure. I will make one quick point here, Jason, is I did come across, again, another great comment from one of the banks, is home sales in 2021, they saw home sales were going to rise about 11%. But they are forecasting, which I don't know if it's good news or bad news, but they're forecasting that home sales in 2022 are going to be negative 20%. So what they're saying is it was a boom in 2021. Home prices were up 16 to 19%. Home sales were up 11%. There was a free-for-all to get a home. But now we're seeing interest rates slowly climb up. And again, their forecasting is RBC that home sales will fall by about 20%.
Yeah, it's not such a bad thing. It's coming back to the median, I think.
Absolutely.
Some of the strategies that we talk to our clients and to the youth, of course, I'm a good example of the bank of mom and dad. So mom and dad have some assets. They've got some cash, some investments. Maybe they've got some life insurance cash value or a home equity line of credit. Mom and dad are going to have to pony up these days.
Well, and it's funny, right? Like, I think about my own two kids, and when I was thinking 20 years ago about being a parent, you think about, okay, I'm going to be a parent. I'm going to have to pay for all the things parents pay for, and at some point pay for their education. Okay, I've got that one covered off. And then, of course, one day they'll get married, and yeah, I'll have to have a little bit of a donation to the wedding. I didn't once think about the fact that it was going to be me who was going to fund their down payment potentially. So parents are under a lot of pressure. And, you know, those that are able to do it, it's great. But I think most of the population are saying, wow, I'm having a tough enough time just paying for their education. Now you're asking me to help them support buying a new home, right?
Yeah, and one of the things we talk to our clients about is just like you said, we do the RESPs, the Registered Education Savings Plan, but when you have a new baby, maybe it's time to start building a get out of my house plan, or put $100, $200 a month, whatever it is, just aside, knowing that there's a possibility you might have to come up with a down payment.
Well, it is funny, right? So you think about, you have that kid and you're thinking about putting away for their education at $200 per month. And now you're thinking $200 for the education, $200 for the house. Maybe in my next life, maybe we won't have any kids. We'll just be spoiled rich,
exactly,
rich workers. Right?
Exactly. Most kids don't realize that if they happen to have some RSPs, there's a first-time home buyers plan, which is a program that allows you to withdraw up to about $35,000. Tax-free. It's a great way to start and get that down payment.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic, right? So again, you buy that, you buy the RSP, you put the money in, you get your tax deduction. At some point, you pull the money back out. And again, it's $35,000, as you said, but of course, they can pay back 1/15th per year. So the minute if they pulled out, let's say they pulled out $30,000 to make it easy math, within a few years of buying that home, they've got to put back in about $2,000. So but again, it's a strategy that works for those trying to find that first down payment money.
Yeah, another strategy we typically talk to kids about is actually just having a plan. Say, look, let's put $500 a month for the next 5 years. If you're early 20s, by the time you're 28, it'll go by like that, and you'll have a good chunk ready to go for that down payment.
I'll never forget when I started working at 23 years old. I talked to some really successful people and said, "What's the secret to success when it comes to money?" And they said, "Create different piggy banks that you can't touch." So I'll never forget it. I went down and I dealt with one of the banks in town here, and I had an account set up for my first home. I had an account set up to get married. I had these different accounts at the bank. But again, like within 3 years of doing that, I had enough money saved at the time that I was able to buy my first house. So times haven't changed that much. But again, you get that young woman in here who lives at home, who is working, hopefully making good income. Yeah, put aside $500 per month. That's about $6,000 per year. You come back in 5 years with a bit of interest, you've got between $30,000 and $40,000 to buy that first home.
Exactly. The last strategy that we talked, not necessarily a strategy, but how about cozying up to the grandma and grandpa? You know, a lot of, we see it a lot. Grandparents have some money earmarked for inheritance for their grandkids. Well, maybe it's time to give it to the kids when they're alive, and they, and what an opportunity to be able to see them buy their own for their first house.
Well, you know, again, grandma and grandpa are sitting there, and probably I always say, do you want to give the inheritance with a warm hand or a cold hand? And again, with the fact that grandma and grandpa maybe hopefully can at some point leave the money behind. The other thing too is one of the strategies is the reverse mortgage too. So these grandparents, if the grandparents said, hey, I have a beautiful home, I have a lot of equity in it, I don't have a lot of income coming in, so I can't touch my income pots. There is some ways to pull equity out of those homes and give it to the grandkids early, and then hopefully see them enjoy the fruits of that bequest. But we do get a lot of questions from our clients. And one of the questions I get a lot, Jason, is, so how much can my child really afford? And one of the notes I came across from one of our mortgage professionals is, if a child makes about $50,000, the typical amount you can afford to buy in a mortgage is about four times your income. So you do want to go and see a mortgage professional on this. But you know, people think, well, I make 40 or 50,000, I can borrow 500 or 600,000. It's simply not true. You're going to have to talk to a mortgage professional on this.
And especially if interest rates are going up, that amount that you can afford is going to be shrinking.
Absolutely. The second key thing here on some of the questions we're asked all the time by our clients about mortgages for the kids is, what's this stress test? What does that mean? And the stress test is basically, it's a means that allow you to pay your mortgage should something happen. So when you go to the bank right now, or you go to your mortgage lender, whoever it may be, they look at the current interest rate, they add about 2% to it. They want to make sure that if something happens to you, if interest rates do go up, that you're not stuck not having enough money to make your mortgage payment. So there is going to be a stress test on those with less than 20% down. Just make sure you're aware of it when you head down to your local lender.
And it's certainly going to come into play, or it could potentially come into play over the next couple of years. If you have a mortgage that you took out last year at a ridiculously low rate, in a year or two, those interest rates can be 2% higher. So can you afford that that payment? That's what the stress test is there for.
Exactly. And we do know that the Bank of Canada has said and come on record to say that they do want to raise interest rates about 2% in the next few years. Not sure how it's going to translate into mortgages, but when the bank starts to promote the fact that we want to raise interest rates, just be prepared for that. Mm-hmm. Another question we get all the time from our clients is, how much do we need for closing costs? So when you close on a house, if the house is $500,000, budget in closing costs between 1.5% and 4%. So that could be anywhere from, you know, $6,000, $7,000, $8,000 up to possibly, you know, $20,000. So you think about it. I need money for the down payment. There's going to be CMHC insurance on the mortgage. That in most cases gets built into the mortgage. But of course, don't forget that when you go to your lawyer, the final closing cost could be another $7,000 to $20,000 on a $500,000 purchase.
Exactly. And one of the things a lot of people forget about is that land transfer fee. And that's about a 1 to 2% of the purchase price. So when you're buying some land or property in Ontario, you're going to pay some land transfer tax.
Yeah, it's painful, right? So yeah. If you're living in anywhere in Ontario, it's 1 to 2% of the purchase price. If you live in Toronto, you pay twice that. So I've had people in Toronto say, I'm going to buy a $1 million condo in Toronto, and the land transfer fees could be, you know, they're twice what they are in Burlington or Oakville or Mississauga. So again, one of those things is, do I want to live in Toronto? Do I want to live outside of Toronto and pay a little bit less? But don't be shocked when you get another big chunk of capital needed for that that closing price. And finally here, first-time home buyers. The one benefit is to being a first-time home buyer is you may qualify for part or all of the tax back. You do want to talk to your realtor and talk to your mortgage consultant on that. But that's a nice win where at least on closing you get part of that tax back.
Well, it can add up 1.5% to 2% on a $1 million home. Can make a big difference.
Absolutely. Sure. So the bottom line out there is that there are ways around it. There's ways to help your kids. There's assets you can use. There's strategies you can use. But like anything, Jason, it's important that I think people go out, have some good conversations, talk to realtors, do your homework, talk to mortgage consultants. I will say one thing. I've worked with a number of really great mortgage people, and they are worth everything that they can drive in that relationship. Don't just go to your local bank. Fine, go to the bank, get your first price, but don't be afraid to shop it around, because you may find that some professionals are able to kind of maneuver the the ability to get you into that house with the least amount of money down. But again, mom and dad are going to help. It's important mom and dad are there to help. And if mom and dad need to pull money out, please, please, please talk to your advisor. Get some advice first. Don't start cashing in RSPs. There may be some assets that you can withdraw prior to that first time purchase, and then hopefully minimize some tax. So hopefully that adds some value to our listeners. Right?
Like anything, it's all about planning.
Absolutely. So again, thanks for watching. Thanks for listening to It's Your Wealth. Again, don't be afraid to go to the podcast on YouTube. It's all up there, and all the shows from previous sessions are there as well. And again, feel free to share the content with your family and your friends. Until next time, stay well and continued success.